tonight. Disgruntled Grub Streeters, why are they there? And how is this a critique of authority? And how can archival footage of Jean-Jacques Rousseau and David Hume help us understand their frustration? On World News, blaming privilege and unnatural inequity as the ideological sources of their misery, the Grub Street occupants champion Rousseauian philosophy as their frustration pushes one sector of society closer and closer to the brink of revolution. Reporting live from Grub Street is Christopher Reed. Chris, how's it going over there?
Excuse me, sir. I'm Chris Reed from World News, and I just wanted to talk to you for a second. Could I get your name and a little bit about what you're doing here?
Yes, my name is Gerard, and we are here to raise awareness about the oppressive practices of the king and his court.
What policies do you not agree with?
Just the foundation of the whole system, the glaring social inequalities that exist. It's like Rousseau said, man was born free, but everywhere he is in chains.
Can you elaborate?
Look around. I mean, it's all over. He only gives literary grants to a privileged select few, and now he is censoring so much that we will not be able to sustain ourselves. Our whole system is corrupt from the top down.
What do you hope to accomplish with this rally?
We hope to cease this rotting regime.
Well, thank you much, sir. Molly, I'm just now getting word from that the royal censor has issued a statement on the matter saying, it is not the practice of this court to set forth motion against itself. Laws which have been passed are to be treated with the same respect as the crown. The king will not be swayed by the words of hack writers who are not even masters of their trade. Back to you in the studio.
So Chris, it is clear that the Grub Streeters' ideology is largely inspired by Rousseauian philosophy. To help shed some light on the philosophical weapons that these writers are wielding, let's take a look back at a World News interview with Rousseau from 1762.
Welcome, Mr. Rousseau. Tell me a little bit about yourself. I understand you're originally from Geneva.
And I lived there until my late teens when I left and began exploring different parts of Italy and France. When I turned 20, I finally made the decision to move to Paris. From that point on, it's a complex tale of ups and downs.
All right, let's get down to what we're here to discuss. I understand you have a new book coming out called The Social Contract, and I've heard that it's a quite compelling piece of work. Tell me a little bit about it.
Well, it's quite simple, really. The book is two things. First off, it is a drawn-out reflection on the current state of society and the irrational nature of our governing bodies. It addresses the hypocrisy and corruption we see within our monarchy and aristocracy. Hypocrisy and corruption that we as a society of people allow. You know, it's these absurd beliefs that are so ingrained within the fabric of our society. Notions of privilege and supposed inequalities that make us allow for its continuance.
I see. Second off?
It is a piece of literature designed to be a blueprint for the necessary evolution of society. You see, Chris, here's the thing. Man is born free, but everywhere he is in chains. The social contract is a liberating device. It is a gift from me to the oppressed subjects of nations. A remedy, if you will, for the retooling of the political relationship between a people and their guardians in the presence of corruption.
Now, some people might see that as fighting words. Do you truly encourage this kind of revolutionary work?
Oh, Chris, always on your toes, no? Well, let's just say, when an important aspect of society is incompatible with the public good, unified civil action needs to manifest.
That's an interesting perspective. Would you consider yourself a man of the people?
I would label myself, hopefully, a catalyst of change.
Well, it looks like our time is up. Thank you again for coming, Mr. Rousseau.
Thank you for joining us this evening. If you are just now tuning in, our top story takes us to Grub Street. Christopher Reed is reporting live right now. Chris, I understand that there have been recent developments.
Hello, sir. I'm Chris Reed. Can I have a minute of your time?
Yeah, of course.
I was wondering who you are and why you have gathered here today.
My name is Jean-Francois. I am a nobleman here to speak out against the reckless ralliers.
Okay, well, they claim you support a system of benefits for the few at the expense of the masses. How do you respond?
naturally, anyone stuck at the rock bottom is eventually going to speak out. And they may in fact be correct to some degree about the corruption. But quite frankly, their literature is trash. Acting out in such a reckless fashion is ridiculous. I think that a few of them smashed in some store windows already.
So do you give any merit to the claims of all these writers?
Well, it is just as important to look at the accuser as the accusation. These writers are poor, they work jobs they are passionate about in order to struggle to feed their family. Meanwhile, they feel that their true passions are ignored and that they must solely be because of the corrupt system.
What are their passions and why are they getting ignored?
Literature, philosophy, the spirits of enlightenment, but sadly they are ignored because they simply aren't any good.
Really?
Oui, it is a sad truth. So naturally, there is a bit of jealousy when they see someone with success like ours. However, the situation is not as black and white as they may portray. I don't even think that they have a plan of any kind for any kind of movement. It all just seems irresponsible.
Well, thank you very much.
This is quite the story we have unfolding now. For a better understanding of the opposition standpoint, I invite our audience to take a look at a World News interview from 1754 with Scottish philosopher David Hume.
I'm joined by Mr. Hume. Nice to meet you and welcome to the show.
Happy to be here again, Chris.
All right, well now I'd like to talk about your new essay you've written called The Idea of a Perfect Commonwealth.
Idea of a Perfect Commonwealth is, as its title alludes to, my consideration of the most positive vision of society and the government's role within this functioning society.
Go on.
You see, in my personal opinion, a more reasonable approach to society and constructing a government may in fact be what is best for the nations of Europe. Without divulging too much, our most important proposition is essentially a system of checking power within and amongst the ruling elite. A call for a more balanced and distributed field of power, if you will. Put it simply, a thought.
Simply a thought? Why is that?
Well, the bulk of mankind, being governed by authority, not reason, and attribute authority to anything that has not the recommendation of antiquity. To tamper, therefore, in this affair, or to try experiments merely upon the credit of supposed arguments in philosophy, can never be the part of a wise man.
Interesting. What are you trying to achieve by writing this text?
All I pretend to in the present essay is to revive this subject of speculation, and therefore, I deliver my sentiments in as few words as possible. A long dissertation on that head would not, I apprehend, be very acceptable to the public, who will be apt to regard such disquisitions both as useless and chimerical. All plans of government which suppose great reformation in the manners of mankind are plainly imaginary.
So then, are we to infer that civil action, based on these theories, can in fact be quite reckless?
Aye, Chris, I believe we can infer this.
Well, thank you for gracing us with your presence again today, Mr. Hume.
My pleasure.
The idea is born from the Enlightenment, of egalitarianism, and man's use of reason. Manifested themselves in so many ways, and in so many differing social groups, that it was impossible to point to a singular or unified impact.
Its true impact on the political atmosphere of the 18th century Europe, particularly France, has continually been a heavily contested subject. The Grub Street writers and their literary outspokenness for an end to the privilege of the mind was merely one example of enlightened thought. And while this accounts for only one small sector of French society, the work of the literary lowlifes cannot be understated. For many of these actors became integral in the revolution when they finally saw the realization of their aspirations. And for those of you joining us from home, thanks for tuning in.
And you stay classy, Paris.
A la Bastille! A la Bastille!
Rock! masses and generations who have kept you down with myths of opportunity, and we give it back to you.
Now I want to talk about this essay that you've recently written. It's called An Idea of a Perfect Society. No, it's not.
Paris, from that point on, is a complex tale of ups and downs. With the Paris, from that point on, is a complex tale of ups and downs.
Oui. Okay. Oui. That's good. Wait, were you filming?
Yeah.
Oh.
Hands and drugs. Cheating athletes are this nation's backbone.
Hypocrisy and corruption. God damn it.
Sweet.
I would label myself. I'm all I can do is you looking at me. Just hold that in front of your face. It's still going.
Oh yeah, whoops.
You want me to stop it?
Yeah.
We gotta choose one.
It says 18. Oh. Oh no, it doesn't. It says modern.
The fruits are still recognizable in modern...
Over the years, the Enlightenment has been defined by many things.
Nope.
No? Sorry. Are we going now?
Yeah, when you're ready.
Okay.
So many people in such a diverse class. No. Damn it, Molly.
Can you elaborate?
Look around. I mean, this is.
Three. That appears to be all the time we have. Thank you again for coming, Mr. Russo. Writers like you are this nation's backbone.
Just leave it, just leave it, I forgot.
No,
just hold out, yeah.
This is
just kick it on, just hold it up. I can't.